Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Michelle Long, it's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines: Asian cheers, open mixed as warnings. Russia could invade Ukraine at any time, rattle investors. U.S. stock futures, though, are still pointing to a higher open. Your tome, the PSE index kicks off trading from 72.70 after losing last week by 2.5% as investors took profit off the table. Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities joins us for a market outlook. This week is going to be big because we're going to be hearing from the Philippine Central Bank. And on our election segment, Political Capital, we'll take a look at the power of branding presidential candidates with marketing expert Amor Maklang of Geiser Maklang Marketing Communications. And we'll also be talking about online dating trends this Valentine's Day with Bumble's Lucille McCart later on the show. All right, we begin with the financial markets. Asian shares starting the week cautiously as fears that Russia could invade Ukraine anytime sent oil prices to seven-year peaks again. The Nikkei 225 led decliners, dropping 2% as markets in Japan reopened following Friday's holiday. South Korea's KOSPI index also down 1.5%, but you've got the stress ASX 200 managing to buck the slide. Oil prices are up near seven-year highs amid concerns about supply, given the tensions in Europe and as demand recovers from the coronavirus pandemic. Brent added another 93 cents to $95.37 a barrel, while U.S. crude rose to over $94 a barrel. In corporate news, India is seeking to sell a 5% stake in the initial public offering of the state-run Life Insurance Corporation of India in what's set to be the country's largest share sale. Over in the Middle East, markets dropping on Sunday as geopolitical tensions escalate between Russia and the West over Ukraine. Saudi Arabia's benchmark index dropping 2% for its biggest daily decline since November of last year. Now, tensions over Russia's military buildup near Ukraine are entering a potentially decisive week, with the U.S. warning an invasion may be imminent. President Vladimir Putin also accuses America of failing to meet his demands. Now, over on Wall Street, U.S. stocks are pointing to a mixed open, with inflation and geopolitical tensions still on top of mind for investors. Futures for the NASDAQ are muted, while the Dow and the S&P 500 are poised to open higher when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, remember, on Friday, Wall Street suffered another deep sell-off as stocks came under pressure due to a hot U.S. inflation report and fears of a Russian attack on Ukraine. All the major indices posting a losing week, with the tech-heavy NASDAQ dropping more than 2%. The declines came as the White House warned of a looming war in Ukraine and urged Americans there to leave immediately. Some airlines have also halted or redirected their flights to Ukraine, while the Pentagon ordered the departure of U.S. troops there. Looking ahead, Wall Street may be in for another volatile week as investors await the release of the minutes of the Federal Reserve's January meeting on Wednesday for any new clues on the central bank's rate hike plans. The U.S. Producer Price Index will also be out this Tuesday, which is expected to be very, very hot after January's Consumer Price Index rose to a new 40-year high of 7.5%. Earnings reports from NVIDIA, Walmart, and AMC are also on deck this week. Now, Saudi Arabia has transferred 4% of Saudi Aramco to the kingdom's sovereign wealth fund. That's worth nearly $80 billion based on the company's market cap. But the state remains the largest shareholder in Saudi Aramco after the transfer process, as it retains more than 94% of the company's shares. Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman said the transfer of existing shares would help boost the public investment fund's assets under management, which are targeted to grow to $1 trillion by the end of 2025. Saudi Aramco, meanwhile, says the move would not affect the number of issued shares or the company's operations, strategy, dividends distribution, policy, or governance framework. Aramco is the world's biggest oil company. Back here at home, local pump prices are set to go up for a, get this, seventh straight week. Gasoline may see the biggest price increase of up to 1 peso and 20 centavos per liter. Diesel prices may rise by 1 peso per liter, while kerosene prices may go up by 70 centavos per liter. Local fuel prices have shot up since the start of the year, bringing diesel prices higher by over 9 pesos per liter. The last time there was a rollback in crude prices was back in December 28th. Industry players say the uptrend in oil prices is still due to lingering supply issues and escalating fears of invasion of Ukraine by Russia. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today, Monday, the start of a brand new week. You've got Indonesia coming out with its December 2021 retail trade figures. Retail sales in Indonesia jumped by 10.8% last November. This was the second straight month of increase in retail trade and the strongest growth since May amid easing COVID restrictions, soaring vaccinations, and a low base effect from 2020. You've also got India coming out with its January inflation numbers. Consumer prices in India rising to 5.6% in December. Now, that was the highest inflation rate since July, but still within the central bank's 2 to 6% target range for a sixth consecutive period. Election season is here, and once again, millions of Filipinos are plunged into the high-stakes world of political advertising. In our weekly segment, Political Capital, we speak with key leaders in the business world about what's at stake in the 2022 elections. And for today, we are joined by an award-winning brand architect, Amor Maclang. Amor, good morning. Happy Valentine's Day. It can't get any lovelier than with a guest like yourself, Amor. And of course, it's your birthday. Happy birthday.
Thank you so much. I thought I was going to comment on the online dating trends.
Okay. Amor, so let's talk about love for candidates, because it's election season, it's campaign season. And I want to start with a very glaring change this year. Brands have become bolder, openly supporting certain candidates. Unlike before, everybody wanted to be neutral, just in case. What does this tell us?
You know, about brands, okay, There are new variables coming out in this particular elections. There are the influencers, but then we've seen something unprecedented, which is there are actually several high-profile brands who have come out openly quite explicitly for and in behalf certain or against certain candidates. This was unthinkable just one election cycle ago. Several things. If you see, if you monitor many of the top conglomerates, they've been largely silent. No? However, the many of the entrepreneurs have chosen to take an opposite stand. Now, this is my opinion as a strategist looking from a risk issues and crisis filter. Just because you have an opinion, does it necessarily mean that you should share that opinion? Especially in the case of big businesses, the opinion of the owner does not necessarily determine the entirety of the opinion of the entire company, right? Can you unequivocally say that 100% of your entire organization says that? And then should you be lucky and you bet on the right horse and well and good? But what if you didn't? What would be the implication of such choices to your stakeholders in general? So I think it's more than meets the eye, and it's not just a matter of having an opinion and being vocal about it.
Mm-hmm. And you made a distinction there, Amor, that the big conglos are still largely silent. It's the entrepreneurs, the MSMEs, who are more vocal about this. Why do you think so?
I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that our MSME segment has been the most affected during COVID. I mean, if there is really an unexpected variable and event that happened, it was COVID, and none of us prepared for that, right? I mean, even the current political machinery is geared towards in-person, right? In-person campaigning, that almost humorous trope about candidates kissing babies. Sadly, there are now guidelines for that, and the rules have changed, and the arena has really largely shifted to digital.
And speaking of digital, I'm very curious. You are, of course, Digital Pilipinas. This is your strong push. But do you think this election is going to be won online? Is social media now king? And in the same breath, you've got disinformation and fake news have become just as ubiquitous.
You know, I'm not going to talk about how majority of Filipinos are online and how we primarily consume or share information based on that. One point that I'd like to share is that this is actually a point of big confusion amongst many of the major candidates. No, so number one, there is this all-powerful algorithm, right? Now, remember in 2016, everyone talked about the phenomenon of trolling, which has been somehow mitigated by the fact that the large social media platforms are now weighing in and clamping down on possible trolls. So that has totally changed the landscape in just under 6 years. Second, the power of the influencers, no? It's rearing its head. Because while social media advertising can be controlled by the platforms, content shared by influencers, whether you're mega influencers or you're micro influencers, the rules haven't been drafted for that. I can only imagine that for the next elections, you know, your Facebook and all your the four horsemen of technology are eventually going to catch up. Now, the big challenge is that many of the political strategists, and I know this sadly far too well, are still a product of the old generation. They don't know how to evaluate and read data. They're all primarily beholden on people's interpretation of data. So the bias really is showing. So sadly, I don't think many of them are taking advantage of the data that's being made available for them. I mean, yes, they do surveys, but still the bias rears its head. And sadly, most of the campaign managers can't even read data properly.
And Amor, it's not just digital advertising. All of the forum, their main platform for being shown to the public would be digital. All online, mostly on Facebook, some on TV still. What do you think about these forums? The different events mounted by TV networks, the KBP, for example, is it still as crucial to participate in them as it was before, as it was 6 years ago, or is it smarter now to just stick to social media, stick to online? Because this morning, we just got the news that the leading presidential frontrunner is not attending another debate.
Okay, so two things. You talked about the forums in the digital speak. I'd like to call them platforms, right?
Okay.
So it's about appearing in the right platforms that are relevant to your community, right? So the forums, debates, okay? Debates basically are a product of an old way of doing things. So, nakomit. Mimi, I might get trolled for this, but you know, that particular type of platform was relevant several cycles back. But now it's a matter of which platform should you appear in that's most relevant to either the market that you're targeting or the market that you are weakest at, right? So it's a function of platform. Second, what it serves to do is primarily just reinforce a particular bias. Now, see, I'm not using the word agenda because what we have right now is clubhouse politics, okay? It's not about agenda. I mean, the narrative is, you know, reads like a Star Wars plot. It's a good versus bad, you know, this party's good, this party's bad. Are you even aware what the relevant agenda specific to your target market or specific to your community, how your preferred candidates stand? I doubt if they do.
Mm-hmm. And that's dangerous, which is why they should be attending these forums and debates.
Exactly. But unfortunately, I think the problem, well, I wouldn't even know if that's a problem because I there are no value judgments here, no. It's just that that's not how we're wired as Filipinos. We're not wired to evaluate based on agenda, right? So they pay lip service to that. Oh, it's because they have an agenda of good governance, right? You might be right, but that in effect is actually a carpet blanket statement. Mm-hmm. If you ask about specific issues, say for example taxation of gamers and gigsters, would they have an opinion about that? I doubt if they do. The abject lack of agenda and policy on a day-to-day basis is really very worrisome for me, because if I wanted to be entertained, Mimi, with a good versus bad plot, I will just stick to watching movies.
Okay. Amor, I want to go now to your expertise, which is being a brand architect. How do we sell a candidate for the highest post of the land, no less?
You know, I'll tell you.
Okay, go ahead.
It's really no different from selling products and services, seriously. There's been a lot of talk recently, the influencer phenomenon that has really exponentially increased with social media has actually caught up in this particular elections. Now it's a function of, do you use one-time, big-time mega endorsers, or do you use, for example, micro-influencers that appear more genuine, more widespread? So it really has gotten down to being a selling of products, right? Selling of products in the polls, except that the stakes are far higher. There have been discussions about influencers getting paid in the upwards of, seven, eight figures, right? And probably even higher. And for me, that is technically acceptable as long as there is transparency. No, I think it's very important if that you declare if you have been hired to work for a particular candidate, as long as it's values aligned, I don't think people will take it against you if you're an influencer supporting a candidate and have been paid for it.
Mm-hmm. Amor, I know that this is really your skill to sell ideas, to push for certain ideas, services. If it's all right, do you think we can get your take on how each of the six presidential candidates can improve their pitch to the Filipino people? What do you think they lack? What they can focus on? We've got a little over 80 more days before the big day. So if, for example, if I ask you, how do you think can the Bongbong Marcos camp boost the messaging? Very quickly, just one tip.
Sure. One for each, right?
Okay, one for each. So let's start with Bongbong.
So in the case, for example, of Bongbong, the fact that he is absent in traditional forums means that he knows the market he's talking to and his bailiwick. So he's talking strongly in the appropriate platform for his market.
Okay. Okay, so that's an explanation why he's not showing up. What about for VP Lenny?
Okay. In the case of VP Lenny, she has such a strong online and Metro Manila-based following. I think if I were in her camp, one of the things I do would be to work doubly harder, more than 18 hours, right? More than 18 hours to go to those areas that are historically not hers, specifically the Visayas and Mindanao area. Mm. So geographically, we really are Federalist in that regard, and in our opinions, even more so.
Okay, how about Senator Ping Lacson?
Senator Lacson.
He's pretty good during the debates.
Here's a challenge, Mimi. Historically, there has never been a winning candidate usually cancels out the narrative of the previous candidate. So we just came from a strong man narrative, and therefore it's quite unlikely, and of course I could always be wrong, it's quite unlikely that the electorate will push for another strong man.
Okay, and how about Manila Mayor Isko Moreno? A wonderful story, rags to riches story. He's always, talking about the success of what he's done in Manila.
I have been an incredible admirer of Mayor Isko, except that I am unclear as to what his singular positioning is. He's been commenting on primarily most issues, but the challenge there is if you stand for everything, then people tend to wonder what you really stand for.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and of course the boxing champ Manny Pacquiao. If this is a personality based competition, this guy has a lot of points because he's known all over. He's brought the Philippines, put the Philippines on the map for sports. Why is he lagging? Why is he lagging in the surveys?
You're assuming, Mimi, that the reason why Senator Pacquiao ran was to win. So what if the intent here is to continue to keep their brands relevant? So whether that's Mayor Isko, or in the case, for example, of Senator Manny Pacquiao, we've seen instances wherein the elections have been used to actually make yourself continuously relevant, right? Because winning or losing one poll doesn't necessarily preclude you from re-engaging back in another format. So you have to wonder, what's the objective?
All right. And of course, Leody de Guzman, labor leader Leody de Guzman. He looks like the underdog here, but you never know. Maybe we could see some surprise there. What is your tip for him running his campaign?
Although he's lagging behind in the polls, if I were in the camp of Mr. de Guzman, perhaps one thing I do is push the agenda. So like I said, it's similar to Senator Pacquiao, right? You might be using this as a platform, in digital speak. It's all about platformification, right? Use this platform to push your sector's agenda. Then maybe you can win in other ways.
Wow. Okay. Wonderful to hear your thoughts on, different angles of looking at this. Amor, I want to end with this because, Digital Pilipinas, this is your advocacy. What can, the next administration do for this advocacy? This is, I know that you're pushing for a 3.0 kind of thing. This is the future.
You know, Mimi, one of the things that we are going to do in the next few months in behalf of Digital Pilipinas is try to push an innovation and a technology agenda. So I'm not here to try to pagsabungin ang mga candidates. That's not what we're here for. But just to get them to start thinking about an innovation and a technology quotient for the country. And it may or may not take roots in this particular election, but if we start seeding it, listen, you are at the forefront, right, of this advocacy, Mimi. I really appreciate you for that. And you know that in this particular space, we could be market leaders. The rest of the world is looking at the Philippines. And it's not just for fintech or open finance, it's technology in general. And yet, how come once again, none of our candidates are championing, you know, this diamond in the rough, right, amongst all of us, which is tech. So hopefully that's what we can do in Digital Pilipinas and working with the next administration, whoever it might be, raise the innovation quotient of the Philippines.
All right. Sounds like a plan there. Thank you very much, Amor, for joining us this morning and for the insights. Always a pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you. Can I comment now on dating?
No. Go ahead. One line comment on dating.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll see you.
Happy Valentine's,
Happy Valentine's Day and happy birthday. All right. Now, moving on to more news, Bongbong Marcos again tops Pulse Asia's latest presidential survey. 60% of respondents said they would vote for the son and the namesake of the late Philippine dictator if the elections were held during the survey period from January 19 to 24. Now, at a distant second is Vice President Lenny Robredo with 16%. Senator Manny Pacquiao and Manila Mayor Isko Moreno are tied for third with 8% each, while 4% of respondents preferred Senator Panfilo Lacson. For Vice President Marcos says, a running mate, Davao Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio, also topped the survey with 50% of those surveyed saying they will vote for the president's daughter. In second place is Senate President Vicente Tito Soto III with 29%, followed by Senator Francis Kiko Pangilinan with 11%, and then Dr. Willie Ong with 5%. A political scientist believes Marcos's unity platform proves effective in pushing him to the top of presidential preference surveys. But Cleve Arguelles notes Marcos is also benefiting from social media propaganda, which targets groups who are vulnerable to disinformation. He also warns skipping presidential forums and debates could be harmful for Marcos's presidential bid.
Voters will really start getting disappointed that, you know, the front runner, the debate front runner, the survey front runner isn't really appearing in interviews and debates so much, right? It's only a matter of time before voters would start demanding that, you know, we want to see you talk, we want to see you respond to these different questions.
Marcos is skipping a presidential debate hosted by CNN Philippines, citing a conflict in his schedule. He earlier snubbed a presidential interview by another network and a forum organized by the Kapisanan ng mga Broadcaster ng Pilipinas. The Quezon Memorial Circle turned pink on Sunday as thousands of supporters of Vice President Lenny Robredo attended a grand rally to show their support for her presidential bid. Due to the thickness of the crowd, it took Robredo and her running mate, Senator Kiko Pangilinan, more than an hour to get from the City Hall to the stage of the QC Memorial Circle. In her speech, Robredo admitted they are facing an uphill battle in their campaign. She also alluded to a viral online series which appeared to be mocking for work ethic.
Alam ko na marami dito mas mahaba pang oras kesa 18 hours ang tinatrabaho araw-araw. Pero ginagawa po natin yan para mas maraming mga kababayan natin ang makausap natin.
Quezon City has 1.4 million registered voters, the highest number among all cities in the Philippines. Partido Lakas ng Masa presidential candidate Leonie de Guzman insists nationalizing public utilities like water and electricity would actually entice foreigners to invest in the country. That's after members of the business sector criticized the labor leader's economic proposal, saying it could result in the departure of foreign investors. In a radio interview over the weekend, de Guzman said utilities which are already privatized in the Philippines should not be allowed to be held by those whose only interest is profit. He adds production costs will be lower if the state runs them instead.
Kasi basic yan eh. Yung tubig at yung kuryente, pati na yung para sa mga tao, yung hospital at eskwelahan, dapat yan ay akuin ng gobyerno at paanda rin bilang serbisyo, hindi negosyo. Mm. At malaking matitipid na ng mga negosyante kung yan ay mahahawakan dahil may bibenta natin ng mura at nakatuon doon sa pagsuporta sa kanila para buhayin yung ating sariling industriya.
Up next, to look at the opening numbers at the start of the brand new trading week with Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities. Market Edge will be right back.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 72.70. And joining us today for his take on the markets, Royce Aguilar of First Metro Securities. Royce, happy Valentine's Day. Thank you for joining us.
Hello, everyone. Happy Valentine's Day.
All right. So, Royce, last week was pretty turbulent. The PSE index closed the week with a 2.5% drop. What do you blame for that? And is the Philippine market going to feel more love this week?
Yeah, actually, last week you saw the effect of the PSE rebalance. It's always because of, you know, funds are really making room for the higher market cap names. Because that's how it works, right? The higher market cap names going in, lower market cap names going out. So they had to sell a bit of the other names. And we saw that in the past couple of PSE rebalancing effectivity prior to the effectivity date. So this week, we expect some more love. for the PSA, especially the sharp drop last week was not really related to something fundamental. It's just it's a matter of rebalancing. So we expect it to rebound this week.
All right. Of course, one of the big events we're monitoring this week would be the Banco Central ng Pilipinas policy meeting happening on Thursday. You know, we're not expecting any big moves. I think we can all agree to that. But are you expecting some change, at least in tone, for future policy decisions given higher inflation in the U.S. and more hawkish central banks around the world? I mean, how long can the BSP stay behind the curve before it hurts the peso and the market anyway?
Well, in terms of that, well, I think they will mention that they will track what will happen in the U.S. That's definitely something they should do, track. I mean, track what's happening. But in terms of, you know, tracking the actual rate hike, it depends on what's happening locally. Because, for example, here, inflation hasn't really, you know, fully rallied or surged because demand hasn't fully come back yet, because we're just in the actual process of reopening. So they will definitely look at more on what's happening locally. So,
All right. So when you look at the PSC index, what range are you looking at?
Well, for now, it's very important that the market stays above 7,000 and the market breaks back above 7,450. Once it breaks back above 7,450, we're looking at a possible 8,000 meters. So it's the past couple of weeks has been very vital, at least for price action for PSA. So it's very important this week that it rebounds, not only partially, but, you know, breaks back above 7,450. That's a price action.
All right. So with that outlook, what do you advise investors? Is now the time to hold? Is now the time to pick up stocks or to sell, to take profit off the table? Because that's sort of what many people did last week.
Well, yeah. I mean, in terms of profit taking, I mean, it's more of rebalancing. I don't really see some big funds really taking profits. More of a rebalancing. So I guess, I mean, for us, it's really a must hold for this market, especially the fundamentals are getting better. I mean, the one thing that we should look at is just the higher oil prices, right? Something to, besides COVID, higher oil prices is something to look forward as a key risk for the market, especially we're a net oil importing country. But other than that, earnings are improving, top line is improving for the companies, and they're really looking forward to adjusting post-pandemic. So it's a must-hold market.
Okay, must-hold market. Royce, let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have. The 97-megawatt Avion power plant of First Gen is now commercially available, not just in natural gas, but even for liquid fuel. We also have this from Century Properties Group. They've set their rate for their up to 3 billion peso five-year fixed rate bond. That's at 5.7524% per annum. They could raise as much as 3 billion, but at least we know that they've earmarked at least 1 billion to be used for affordable housing projects under their brand, First Park Homes. Talk to us about the property sector. Are you more bullish now on property? Is it time to buy them?
Well, for property, yeah, we recognize the fact that, you know, it's going to recover, definitely. We mentioned that. But we consider that, for example, the mall is going to take some time because, for example, there is the actual reopening, but in terms of confidence, people will have to see, people will have to have more confidence in going out in the first place, right? But nevertheless, we're positive on the long-term prospects. Actually, one of our top sector picks for this year. So it's just a matter of time to be patient. In terms of reopening sectors, you're already seeing the banks recover. And it's just a matter of time the property recovers as well. It's just a matter of taking a see what's happening on the ground. And definitely what's on the ground, it's improving. It's just a matter of, you know, having that confidence.
And would infrastructure play also be a big reopening play for you? Because mobility will, you know, improve, more people will be out there using those roads and bridges and highways. Because we have this, NLEX Corporation is conducting major repairs of bridges in Pampanga to ensure the safety of motorists using NLEX and SCTEX. So would these, you know, toll roads operators also be enjoying, you know, tailwinds from reopening big time?
Yeah, definitely. It's just that usually we actually have a data that a construction activity usually goes up prior to the election and post election. There's just a short period of time because of I think there's a ban prior to the election. But definitely, prior to the election, a lot of people are catching up prior to the ban. And then post-election, usually in a normal economy, construction picks up again. So yeah, especially right now, there's really a lot of room to make up. So yeah, infrastructure is definitely one thing to also watch out for.
And what about this one? This used to be a pandemic story. You know, people who were cooped up in their homes wanted to take care of pets. So they, a lot of them got new dogs and cats. Well, Pilmico, their animal nutrition side, is actually the Maxime brand, is launching a new cat food line. So lots of, fur parents really got onto the bandwagon of getting this. And finally, here's another interesting story from Campi. This time about auto sales. Not so good news. Auto sales for the first month of this year falling 11% to 20,765 units sold. Quick comment on cars, on the auto industry.
Well, it's very clear, right, in terms of automotive sales, that it's in line with what's happening in terms of their reopening, in terms of the quarantine measures. And last January, we saw the Omicron surge. So that's probably the reason for it. But moving forward, as the economy reopens, we're confident that they will that car sales will recover. So it's best to take a look at the listed names and their exposure to the automotive sector.
All right, let's go over some interesting foreign stories. One is, Royce, have you seen Adidas's new ad for a sports bra line? The ad doesn't show any bra, but a grid of 25 pairs of bare breasts in all their natural diverse glory. The tagline is hashtag support is everything. You know, speaking of ads, it's election season, it's campaign season. And this is supposed to be big for companies, for brands. Which listed companies do you see winning big during this season?
Well, yeah, I mean, in terms of looking what to benefit, we usually drill down to the economy side. So in terms of which sectors benefit, like for example, consumer, you're also seeing automotive because the caravans, the parades, and the like. So those are the usual sectors that will benefit. Consumer, not only discretionary, but consumer staples, as a lot of people, you know, give away stuff to the ones that are needed or to their constituents, right? So yeah, those sectors also benefit during election season. We actually have this economic data that during election years, there's a 1.3% data, which is stronger compared to non-election years. So definitely the economy is poised to do better. It's a must need, right? Especially as the economy recovers. It's the lift we need. But of course, post-election, what we want is a clear policy. So that's what investors should look at now.
All right. We've come to the most exciting part of the conversation. Royce, talk to us about your blind item stock, a stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us. Just describe. We're going to leave it to our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us this morning?
Well, this stock has been recovering so far, right?
Okay.
It's the epitome of recovery. In terms of earnings, it showed how well it recovered, right? Especially from its previously loss-making businesses. It showed strength in the recent earnings release. It's one of our new top picks, especially where we're expecting a significant economic reopening, and hence this stock will recover as well. So that's it.
How much upside are you seeing for this stock? You know, this stock used to be the darling among consumer names, you know, trading very expensively, and then it fell from there because of some challenges with earnings. But how much more upside are you seeing in share price?
Nearly 20%. So it has that certain upside that investors will be comfortable holding, especially where in terms of the reasons why it dropped before, right now there's really a path to profitability. So that's why it's one of our topics.
All right. On that note, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is for that 20% upside. Royce, thank you so much for joining us. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Looking forward to our next conversation.
Thank you, everyone. Have a seat.
Okay. Now, we are taking a quick break. Coming up, a look at online dating trends on this day of hearts with Bumble's Lucille McCart. Stay with Market Edge. We'll be right back.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
It's Valentine's Day, and while love is in the air, it's also apparently on the app. We're glad Bumble's APAC Communications Director, Lucille McCart, can join us this morning. Lucille, happy Hearts Day.
Happy Valentine's Day. Thank you for having me.
All right. So Bumble has been gaining popularity. I know some Hollywood superstars are on it. I read that Sharon Stone is on Bumble. So tell us, Lucille, how does it work? What I know is that women make the first move and you swipe right for people that you
exactly
like.
Exactly right.
So how does it work?
Bumble is for everyone to use. And when men and women are using it, when you've matched, the woman has to make the first move and start the conversation. And the idea behind that is we're trying to give women the opportunity to feel empowered in their dating lives and feel like they have control over their dating journey. But yes, as you said, swiping right and left is a big part of it. And then once you've matched, the woman has to make the first move and really get the conversation going. And that's what makes it so exciting.
But by women making the first move, it also means women pay for every match. Is that accurate?
No, so Bumble is free to download and free to use.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone can pay for Bumble Premium. So by paying for Bumble Premium, you get access to special features. So that could be having access to the beeline, which is where you can see the people that have already expressed interest in you. You can do things like use Spotlight, which bumps you to the top of the queue and, you know, puts you ahead of everyone else for a little while. And you can use things like Travel Mode, which allows you to drop yourself anywhere in the world. For example, if you're planning to travel, I'm in Sydney. So if I was planning to travel to Manila, which hopefully I'll get to do this year, I could place my profile in Manila so I could set up some dates for when I arrive.
But it's either men or women can pay.
Anyone can pay.
So this is how you generate the revenue, right?
Yes. Yeah. Correct.
Okay. And how big is the Philippine market for Bumble? I can imagine with so many apps, how are you finding more creative ways to win the love of singles? And it's not just singles because you also have other categories aside from love.
Exactly right. The Philippines is a very important market for us. We know that people in Philippines love love. Everyone in Filipinos are very passionate about love. So that is what makes it so exciting for us. We also know Filipinos are early adopters when it comes to technology. They're one of the most engaged social media users in the world. So that makes Philippines really exciting opportunity for us. And we started doing some active marketing there about 6 months ago, and we're really excited to see more and more people in the Philippines using Bumble every day. And as you said, it's not just for dating. dating. So our dating platform is our biggest platform, but we also have separate modes within the app called Bumble BFF, which is enables you to find platonic friendships, and Bumble Biz, which allows you to make professional connections.
Exciting. I'm curious, are you on Bumble, Lucille?
Yes. Yes, I am. Successful Bumble user.
Okay. So let's move on now. So did Filipinos swipe right for romance in the last 2 years of the pandemic? I know that you came out with a survey on trends. What does that tell us? What are the revelations?
Yeah, we're seeing really interesting things in the way that Filipinos have adjusted their dating style throughout the pandemic. When the pandemic first started, we saw a really big shift to virtual dating and video dating and people getting to know each other online before they considered meeting up in person. Obviously, when you're in lockdown or social distancing, it's hard to go on an in-person date. And what that led to was also the idea of slow dating. So people slowing the courting process down, getting to know each other a bit better before they met up in person. And that actually is a really positive trend because it sets you up for a much better, much stronger connection, a stronger foundation on which to build a potential relationship. But we're also seeing trends like the experience of the last 2 years has made people more focused on things like they're looking for an emotionally available partner. That's something that is more important to them than, say, looks or occupation or things that were very important, you know, pre-pandemic. We're looking for someone, and especially people in the Philippines are looking for someone that can be a really great partner to them. So that's becoming more and more important. But then we're also seeing some fun trends like, as we start to get out of lockdown and social distancing, Filipinos are a bit more open to public displays of affection as well, because, you know, we've all been, you know, restricted in how we can behave in public for so long that people are really excited to get out there and express themselves.
Mm-hmm. Is it true also that the main trend for this year is consciously single?
Yes.
77% of the people you surveyed at least realize it's okay to be alone for a little bit.
Yeah, so the idea of being consciously single is not necessarily that you're not dating or that you're not putting yourself out there. It's that you're recognizing that being single is actually really fun and it's a great experience and it allows for a lot of personal growth. So you're being more intentional in how and when you date and you're being more mindful about it. So you're actually setting yourself up to go into your dating experience and have a much more positive experience because you're putting less pressure on yourself. And you know, it's okay to be single and I'm happy being single, but you know, if I happen to find a partner throughout this process, that's fantastic. And if not, maybe I'll just have some really fun dates along the way.
Okay. So you swipe right when you like them, you swipe left if you don't. Do you have KPIs, key performance indicators, or metrics to measure the success of the app in terms of, you know, meeting goals? I mean, how much of the swipe rights end up in a match? How many matches end up in marriage, for example?
Yeah, all of those things are important, but what has become increasingly clear over the last, you know, 12 months, 2 years, is that success looks different for everyone. So for some people who are really enjoying their dating experience, success might be a really fun conversation where you got to know someone, or it might be a really fun date. Or it might be a couple of really fun dates. And for some people, it's a relationship that turns into something serious that leads to marriage and babies and all those amazing things. So we know that a lot of people in the Philippines are looking for a serious relationship and to settle down, but that doesn't mean that you can't find success along the way in getting to know new people, having fun experiences. So yes, there's a lot of different success metrics that we look at, but we also are recognizing that it's different for everyone. So the more time people spend on the app, if they are having a great experience, it doesn't actually matter if they're not settling down into a relationship as long as they're enjoying themselves.
Mm-hmm. You know what they say, sometimes you have to kiss a few frogs before you find the prince.
Right.
Final question, Lucille. You know, Bumble, and you talked about this briefly earlier, it's a very female-focused dating app. I know it was founded in 2014 by Whitney Wolf Hurd and Andre Andreev, who was the founder of dating app Badu. Wolf Hurd was one of the co-founders of Tinder, which she eventually left. And here we are with, a $13 billion dating app, Bumble. Why are you putting it in women's hands? The power, you talked about putting the power of choice in women's hands. And I guess more importantly, is Asia, which is still a very patriarchal, sometimes old-fashioned society, are Asians ready for this to happen without the stigma?
Yeah, I think they are, absolutely. I think there's a lot of women in a lot of markets that Bumble is operating in that are really excited about the opportunity to feel empowered and feel like they have control over their dating life. And you mentioned our CEO, Whitney, earlier, and one of the most compelling things that she has said that I've heard since working at Bumble is one of the reasons that she founded the business was because she looked around at all of the successful women that she knew, and she saw so many of them that were making amazing strides in their professional life and really fighting for equality in that sense and not taking no for an answer and fighting the gender pay gap and doing all of those types of things, but who still took a back seat when it came to their dating life and still waited for men to ask them out, waiting for men to ask their number, waiting for men to take all of those steps. And she just thought that was crazy. And when you think about it, it is, you know, as women, you know, there's no reason why we can't initiate a first kiss, for example, or ask someone out on a date. And the more you do those kind of things, the more you realize there's actually no reason why you can't. So it's something, it's a message that we're really excited to be bringing to more and more Asian countries. And I think the more Asian women that we speak to in Philippines and Singapore and other markets that we're operating in, you know, what we hear is that idea of being excited about the opportunity and trying something new. And while there might be a stigma, I think it's changing fast and we're really excited to be part of that journey.
Very, very powerful tool. Of course, must be used responsibly. Lucille, thank you so much for sharing the insights, for joining us today. It was a pleasure getting to know Bumble more. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Now, true love may cost a little more this Valentine's Day. The global supply chain crisis is hitting the flower industry, pushing prices up a single stem of rose in the U.S. to get this, $50 to $70 a stem. Florists admit this makes it increasingly difficult for them and major retailers that rely on imports to price their bouquets reasonably. Here at home, prices of bouquets have nearly tripled due to high demand this Hearts Day. A bouquet of local roses now costs up to 1,000 pesos from just 500 pesos, while a single stem of an imported rose is now priced at 150 pesos from just 60 pesos before the Valentine's season. According to the U.S. National Retail Federation, consumer spending is expected to reach $23.9 billion this Valentine's Day, with flowers being the third most popular gift item at 37% after candies and greeting cards. And before we go, for those who tried to guess our blind item, this is the stock pick of Royce Aguilar. He says this stock is looking at a 20% upside in share price. A pretty strong recovery in earnings, reversing net losses. Well, you guessed it. This stock is Jollibee Foods Corporation. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that's it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Happy Valentine's Day. Have a meaningful one. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out.